This is episode zero of In Victoria's Garden, and we're just going to be talking about what we want to do. What is your name?
What is my name? My name is Granny Smith.
You're Granny Smith, okay. Well, it's I'm glad that you're here with us today, Granny Smith. I'm just going to check and make sure we have we seem to have some audio. Okay, I'm going to go to the... Start this off today?
Well, the way I've always been taught of starting anything is with endpoint visualization. And I learned that from a man named Vic Lindell, who is a coach here in Victoria. And what he did with volleyball teams is he would have people look at what end result they wanted. And then what he would do is creatively have them visualize this and look at where they're going. So I think the first thing we should do is say, you know, where do we want to be and how will we arrive?
Okay, well that's pretty much what I want to talk about. It seems to me that we've got a lot of people who are trying to fix the current systems. And in my opinion, the current systems are sort of beyond
flexibility.
We're not really at a point where we can fix anything anymore. We've gone beyond that point. So, meanwhile, there are all these people who are really smart and really intelligent folks, and they're working sort of without anybody really making much of a fuss about them. They're doing things, and they're doing permaculture. They're working on their own consciousness too. So I want to spend a lot of time on consciousness. This show really is one of the main subtexts of the show is going to be consciousness. How do we change our consciousness so that we effectively create a new world? Oh, I do have a quote.
Well, while you're looking for that, what I'd like to say is just the sort of the notes that I have made are regarding, as I said, this endpoint visualization. So it would be my vision and my mission, and then that would funnel down to my goals.
Right.
And what I saw as sort of my umbrella as my vision would be a world where human beings could live in a symbiotic relationship. And what I mean by that is being interdependent, because symbiotic relationships are not always positive, but relationships with themselves and nature, because we are living in nature as much as we're trying to kill it off. And then my mission would be to create a peaceful, respectful climate for communication in the human network, using the model of how plants, specifically fungi and trees, do that. And I've been doing a little bit of reading about that. It's actually quite fascinating. So what I see my goals as being are things such as creating awareness about this possibility, which I think basically is what you're saying, and doing that so that with a weekly discourse on the subject. And then we would create respectful dialogue. Now, I was asked a question once, what do you think the main source of a good relationship is? And almost everyone would say communication. But apparently that's not number one. Number one is respect.
Respect, yeah.
So I think we have respect for one another. We have respect for the things around us. And especially we have respect for nature and an awful lot to live in nature.
Okay.
Those would be a couple of my thoughts.
Anything else right now, or do you want me to?
eventually I'd like to talk about the secret life plants, and that's important because often we think of animals as having certain consciousness, and plants are just something that we use to sustain ourselves, and if we're going to be self-righteous about it, then give up animals, concentrate on just plant forms of sustaining life, and you know, maybe we don't know everything we need to know about consciousness and plants, and that's
I think one of the things that we can do that'll really make this a lot better is if we put some little side lights here. Not bright lights, just little lights. Because your face is in the shadow on the side.
Yeah. So. Well, unfortunately, it's my bad side. I mean, if I had a bad side, that would be it.
All right, we'll go back to the wide shot. The wide shot's a little washed out. So
work on making that a better camera.
Okay, well, one of the things that I can't find the quote. I have this little paper with a quote from Buckminster Fuller, and he said something, you don't change by fighting against an old system. You make it obsolete by creating a new system.
Yeah.
And that's what I see happening, frankly, is that, you know, who wants to eat GMO food or food that tastes like cardboard? Once you've tasted good food and you have a garden and you get into a relationship with your plants, well, we're getting back to that. We're getting back to finding out that really is quite high technology. And as Michael Pollan discovered, the single most significant indicator of health for a human being is whether their food was prepared by another person or a family or a corporation. So if it was prepared by a corporation, the chances are that your health is going to be deteriorating. If your food is prepared by another person. Now, of course, that's not a rule that's absolutely holds fast. It's just a generalization. In general, that's what it is.
Well, in my nutrition courses, what I learned is the two things that affect us are nurture and nature, those things that we inherit, or those things that we're predisposed. Our body, we're born with a body that is predisposed for health in certain areas and weakness in certain areas. So, for instance, a baby who's born too early, there's maybe in the area of their lungs. You know what, a full-term baby may even be more robust, but it depends on what you inherit. And then there's your environment. So you can't do much. You've chosen who you're going to have as a mom and dad. You've already done that before you got here. Then once you arrive, you have to interact with the nature. So the nature is where we need to have each other's backs. And that is that if we're criticizing one another all the time and looking for faults, it's really hard to support one another. And I'll look more into that about the relationship with God and trees and so forth at some point.
Okay, another thing that I want to do on this show is I want to talk about books. So I've got some audio books, and we have a post-apocalyptic author in our midst here on Vancouver Island, Leah Tassie, and she's written some books. Well, this one's called Green Blood Lives, and it's about the trees. And I thought one thing that might be kind of fun to do sometime when we don't have maybe much to talk about, or just as a change, we can just read out loud.
Yes.
And we could do it like, say, okay, you read here, you read here, because these are really interesting books, and you know, post-apocalyptic literature is not really that popular, but this is really fun because it happens right around here, right around Vancouver Island.
Yeah.
And then there are the Anastasia books that we love to talk about, because that's already happening in Russia. People are starting to take care of the land, and of course we see that you know, this territory here, let's talk about that a little bit. This territory here is Vancouver Island. We're streaming here from somewhere in the underground, Victoria, and but this land is unceded land. It still belongs to the First Nations people, and we're just here sort of luckily by their grace.
Yes, absolutely.
So we want to talk about that a little bit. I've got my teacher today says
Republic of Vancouver Island, which
I got from some guy that sells paintball stuff. I think he's retired now. But
yeah.
Anyway, there are all sorts of possibilities here. We can also consider ourselves. This is in the bioregion of Cascadia, so we can talk a little bit about what Cascadia. Why is Cascadia different from other regions, and why are the people who live in Cascadia? Why do they share similar ideas? You find that, for example, that the ideas that are happening here on Vancouver Island and up Ireland and in Washington and Oregon and Northern California, that area is all Cascadian. And we find that the people who live there think a lot different from the people who live in, say, Ontario or east of the United States. And that's something that sometimes we might feel that they're not really treating us the way, and treating the land especially, the way it should be treated. So we can sort of watch that and identify what's happening there. What else?
Well, one of the main things, I mean, my background is in sales and promotion and all that sort of thing. So a lot of what I've always done is, right from the beginning when I was a young mother of 25, and I went into the business of marketing educational programs and tools. And so, of course, you have to get some sort of something to always keep yourself up. Because if you go in and sell something to someone and you say, I just painted this rock, you don't want to buy it, do you? You know,
doesn't generate enthusiasm.
No, not a lot. You know, so you have to look for positive things. So the third thing on my list of goals was to move forward in a positive direction where the Earth's inhabitants are served and felt and self-expressed. And in my reading, what I found out is that we treat trees as though they're fakes, and they're actually sentient beings.
Right, they are living. They are.
They are.
Also,
they communicate.
Creatures, they communicate. They're actually at quite high. We don't even know.
Well, there's one woman, Suzanne Smart, I think is her name. She's a forester in Vancouver. And this morning I was looking for her YouTube. I didn't find the long YouTube, but it was a short little 6-minute clip, so if anyone wants to look that up. But she talks about, in the forest, there's a mother tree.
Right.
And I mean, I just get, as a mother and a grandmother, I just get so moved by this concept of just looking out and seeing, you know, there's no way I could have supported this many children, but here this mother tree sits. And as far as you can see, are her children. And they're all connected. Connected to the point where two trees can be connected, and when one dies, they die together just the same as people in a long-term marriage do.
Because they're so connected.
They are. They're so connected. So the point is, we need to be positive about what we're doing so that we can express ourselves. I mean, if we're crossing our arms after pushing a child into the deep end of the pool and we're just expressing our displeasure because they aren't swimming and we have taught them nothing, then, you know, we learn a lot by what's happening at the moment in politically in our world. We're learning what not to do and what doesn't work. And you see that because people keep falling away, falling away, falling away. People don't fall away from things they love. They're drawn closer.
Well, another thing that doing this live stream will let us do, for example, if we wanted to, like if you wanted to bring up a YouTube, we could just bring it up and rebroadcast it.
Oh, great.
And you know, so that everybody knows what we're doing, what we're talking about, so we're on the same page.
We can also
put in, you can put in JPEG,
right.
You can put in whatever.
I was just going to say, there was so much green, you know, so much green. And when I lived in Texas, I went to university in Natalie, Texas. And when I came back to Victoria, my friend and I were driving out to Butchart Gardens. If you've ever gone out to Butchart Gardens, I mean, the beauty is unbelievable before you even get to the gardens. And I looked up and I noticed something that I never ever noticed before. And that was cameras. It's a little like the Eskimos looking at the snow. They have, you know, many, many names for
the snow.
Yeah, for the snow. Well, this green, I kept looking and staring at this green because in Texas, where I was, and one of the elders in our church, and, you know, he said, well, you haven't really seen Texas because you haven't seen Corpus Christi. And I'm sure Corpus Christi was beautiful with all these greens, because all I had been surrounded with for so many years was all of this brown. And I came back to Victoria, and I just, ever since I've been back here, I've just felt so blessed to live in this area because of all the greenery. It was just absolutely gorgeous.
Well, yeah, this is a beautiful place. I feel very much at home here. And it's amazing that it's so much like the rainforest in Costa Rica. Recognize a lot of things. Well, the other thing is we've got a lot of people. We've got some people working here in Victoria, for example. We've got the river. What is that group that's doing the...
It's daylighting. So they're daylighting.
They're daylighting Rock Bay Creek daylighting,
and what they're doing is, well, there again, there's a whole film in Britain of what they did in the rivers underneath London.
So yeah, so we could show clips from that. And another one is we've got some people here who are involved either being deaf doulas or the Deaf Cafe, Don Morris, and I'd like to get him on the show and talk about it. Because what we're finding out is that one of the things that is really sort of quintessential for us to change our consciousness, to change the way we think, is to get over our fear of death and to find out that death isn't such a scary thing, but rather it's just a transition, and if your consciousness is right and your consciousness is in touch with who you really are, instead of something that's been paced in 25 years ago in our society, that death is just not even very noticeable.
It's a doorway or a crossing of the veil, and I always try my new ideas out on my very intelligent 7-year-old grandson, you know. And I said, you know, we say things are dying, but really they're just going through a transition.
Right.
And it's like there's this veil.
They're changing.
Yeah, and even on that program we're watching on Netflix, Once Upon a Time.
Right.
And remember when they went into this storybook land, and if somebody crossed this invisibility, they couldn't be seen. They were here, and they could look, and they could see on the other side, but the other ones couldn't see them, you know? So it's like that. So I told him that when Granny makes her transition across the veil, they'll still be there. They'll still be there.
Yeah, so we've got a lot of resources to talk about death and leading into resurrection. We've got Francis Tiso, who's outside of Rome. He's an American, but he lives outside of Rome. He's an expert on Buddhism and life body resurrection. And he said that he would do an interview with us. We were just listening to this, which is The End of Reincarnation, Gary Renard, which is an exposition. It's basically about the A Course in Miracles. And that talks about our transition to a new way of being, you know, consciousness, which will be radically different from the experience that we're having right now. And the thing is that we want to talk about these things that aren't really talked about very much, because we all need to get these things normalized so that it doesn't seem so strange.
Yeah.
I mean, when I say resurrection, people don't go, what is he talking about? Is he talking about
religious?
It's not really anything to do with religion.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what religion you are. It's just something that's totally out of our control, and it's happening all over the planet. And we have some Russian contacts with people who are actively healing, just using mental techniques, and who are very successful at healing people from, say, stage 4 cancer or stage 4 AIDS. And these guys are, well, they're two that I particularly follow. Arkady Petrov, I'm doing some video work for them. I'm making dubbing the Russian movies, dubbing into English, French, and also Gregory Grammer plays another language, closely associated with Petrarch. Again, these two guys are some of the most visible ones, but it's happening all over, and we're just not, we don't talk about it on the mainstream news or discussion groups because it's too woo. And then you start getting into discussions about, you know, now you start talking about flying saucers and reflections, ayahuasca, LSD, all these different things. They all seem to be different, but the more you look at them, the more they're really the same. They're just harbingers of what's happening on this planet, where we're going. One of the other things that I like to think about that makes me really feel very optimistic when I look at the world right now, I see all the bad stuff that's going on around us, is that in sociology, it only takes 10% of the population who really believe in something, that really believe in an unshakable way, in a new way of thinking, for the entire population to shift. Father Tiso calls it the 100th monkey. He identifies it with the 100th monkey. But at any rate, this could happen within our lifetime.
Sure.
I mean, the change, those people who have been through a near-death experience, they know that they're not their body. They know that they have an existence outside their body. And so as a result, they treat the earth in a different way. I mean, you can't help it but take a longer-term view of things if you are in touch with that, in touch with your consciousness. Yeah, we have a lot of things to talk about.
Yeah, but I think that one thing I just don't want to step over, and that is when we watch the Master and Margarita, it's all of a sudden I realized that they were drinking wine and then they fell down. They went, my goodness, why would they be killed off? And then they woke up and they rose again. And it wasn't until having watched that so many times that I finally got the definition of resurrection, which is
standing up.
To stand up again. And that's what they did. And it's almost like in the Bible when it talks about the death of the old life, you know, the old person.
Yeah.
And then the new person. The other thing I was going to say too is I'm sure that we're passing will come and chat with us.
I'm sure that there are a lot of people who like to talk about things.
There's people we can do remotely, like Father Tiso, who's a Catholic priest, but his doctorate is in Buddhism. So, you know, he's a multifaceted, you know.
Yeah, multicultural, too.
Yeah, so. Exactly, yes. And so he's a fabulous guy. Who quotes you, so hey, must be good, eh?
I don't know about that, but. Anyway, yeah, there are lots of really interesting things to talk about, which is why we're doing this. We also have a friend who did a story, who improvised a story for us, so we can have him on. The bird.
Oh yes, yes, yes.
The bird story, the beautiful bird.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
And there are just all sorts of resources around here, and the thing is. This is basically free studio time. We're here, we can use this whenever we want. Right now, we're going to focus on doing it on Tuesdays at 1 p.m. So we're going to have our first show next Tuesday at 1. This is show number 0. We're just checking things out. And we have to work on the audio. This is our microphone. Great. And also the lighting. We have some
signs. Maybe
whatever. If we just put some lights over here, then it won't be in the shadow.
Sure.
We've got these lights that are pretty good. But let's see, what else do we want to talk about?
One of my other goals is to be ongoingly curious about nature and how nature deals with adversity and take the parts that work for us. Like, I did a workshop once where the leader said, I'm going to give you a bunch of information. Some of it you're going to go, I don't know about that, and others you're just going to really embrace. What your job is to do with the things that you kind of don't resonate with is just to keep them on your lap like bricks, and then at the break you get up, and whatever it's not doesn't resonate with you just falls off. You know, so for each person it will be different, but I think the main thing is to be curious, and I think that's one of the best things about being a grandparent, is you get to look at the world through a child's eyes. You know, I just made a book for my daughter for her birthday, and it had a bunch of pictures, mostly of her son, because that's the love of her life. And then the other thing was that they had pictures of her and that. And so he wanted to find a particular picture that, you know, he was having a hard time finding. He says, you know, Granny, here's a thought. He said, next time you do one of these, why don't you put numbers on the pages? And you know, that list that you put at the beginning, then you do one of those too. But, you know, that's a good idea. Because when you do these photo books, they're 40 pages, you know, and I feel like I memorize them every time I finish them, but I realize that new people looking at them have all the same experiences I do.
Yeah, of course, another thing that we want to talk about on this show is we're using this equipment. This entire studio is about $250 worth of equipment. So we want to talk about how we did that using open source software, using the book.
And make new friends on Facebook too that want to give you things.
Right, yeah, we can thank Barbara for the cameras and one of the tripods.
And a beautiful lens that fits my hand.
Oh yeah, that filter. And I mean, the stuff we're using here, these cameras are just great because they have a composite.
I feel like I need a full-price lens right here right now.
They have a composite video output that we can feed into these inexpensive cards in the computer. And, you know, I've got them zoomed in, and they, I don't know, if they had a little bit more light, they'd be really pretty decent. They're still kind of dark right now, but we'll get this down. We'll get this so that it works.
Well, as I'm minimizing at home, you know, I'm going again to my guru called YouTube and saying, what's resonating with me? You know, what sparks joy? That book I felt was a little bit too constricting for me. And I found out why, because I went to one YouTube by a woman who was talking about your particular kind of a hug. You know, and her little one was a ladybug, and I thought, oh, great, I know I'm a ladybug.
Oh, you mean the type of
organization
person? Right, I remember that. Yeah. What was I?
Maybe a butterfly. We can find out, then we can share that. But the whole thing is, I have to have things visual, and I was always beating myself up. Now, the disorganization needs to go, but I still do need things to be visible. Others need everything in the drawer, everything off the top surfaces, and that is one of my daughters, you know, so.
So we can see that was another thing, like when we talk about something, we should probably write it down, and I think that on YouTube at least I can stick a trailer on it, and we could describe all those things. This is really experimental right now, everybody. We're just trying to learn what works, what doesn't, how to make this so it's easy. I think it took me about 20 minutes to set up this time, and I think I'll get better at that. I think I'll get it down to about 12 minutes or something.
And we might get some apprentices who want. In fact, you met somebody here last time.
That's a good point. we want to spread this technology. We're living in a time that's changing so fast that people don't even realize what's possible and what's impossible.
Right, and the reality of it, as you become grandparents, your energy diminishes, you know. Sometimes you feel like it's diminishing every day, but certainly every month and every year, you're just a different person this time this year than you were last year. And so what we have found is that it's really important to pass on the knowledge that you have. Now, what makes a person a leader? Usually it's only that they're the ones with the flashlight and the map, and that's all the difference there is. You're at the head of the line going, I have no idea what I'm doing, but I got the map and the flashlight, so we'll figure it out together. And I think there's much more power in coming together like that and having a seven-year-old say, hey, what about this? And saying, you know, you're right. Being curious, open, and listening to a youth, no matter how old they are, has to contribute to something. Because when you're, like, I used to be a know-it-all, but, you know, my level of knowing went like that. And as I aged, I realized just how arrogant that is to be a know-it-all.
Hey, you know, another thing we could do that would just be fun is have Jenny Schultz on,
yeah.
and maybe some of the kids who have participated in the Growing Young Farmers program to see how they see the world. I mean, because, you know, a child who has been taught to make their garden, grow their garden, and to raise chickens will have a different point of view about things than a child who thinks that all food comes from a grocery store.
Yeah, exactly. I just want to quote just something from Ubuntu. Michael Tellinger is a man who lives in Africa. He has South Africa. And he's a very interesting personality. You know, it doesn't matter who you are, it will be first name, last name, and all of the Google searches of how great a person you are and how wonderful your philosophy is. And then you'll see scam, fraud, fake, and all of that kind of thing. So when you look up any of these people that we see, because we're more or less on the leading edge of things and we're willing to take risks, a lot of these people may sound a little odd to you. Michael Tellinger may be that person, but you know what? He's an accomplished musician, an actor. You never see any of that part of him. What you see from him is his commitment to people and to the world, and to the world working, and basically us not working, about creating a life where you have a simple life, and it's not all about how am I going to, you know, sell my really expensive house, or keep my membership in the country club, or keep up with the Joneses. You know, we're often trying to impress people that we don't even like, you know, we have nothing in common with them. But somehow, if we didn't get a degree or we don't have an income at a certain level, that we aren't equal to them. And quite frankly, on the basic levels of human being, we're all equal. It doesn't matter if we're handicapped in any sort of a way, whether we're challenged mentally or anything, we're all just human beings doing the best we can with what we have. So I just wanted to say that what he says is the meaning, I think this is the meaning of Ubuntu, I am who I am because of who we are. And it's so true. If it wasn't in us, what is the point of even living? There needs to be something or someone to interact with.
Yeah, the way Gary Renard says it is that we are in this experience of separation. We can't feel that we are connected to each other. But that's part of the process of waking up.
Yeah, that brings that. Yeah, exactly. And I think I said something about awakening in here somewhere. I mentioned it. But the other thing, too, is that brings us full circle back to the mycelium there underneath.
Oh, yeah,
the
read
earth.
That.
And there's a lot to read.
About the mushrooms not being individuals, because that was another Gary Renard quote.
What I've written down here is have an inquiring mind, be a detective looking for what's right. There's enough people out there looking for what's wrong, and we just don't need those anymore. There's a lot of stuff that I haven't thoroughly read, but I just wanted to say a couple of things. One is the World Wide Web. The wood wide web are trees. They are conscious. They actually have feelings. They communicate with one another. Let's take the giraffe, who happens to be my favorite animal. So here he is over in Africa with his long neck, and you have an acacia tree up here. And he's going like this. He's wanting to eat this acacia tree. Well, you know what the acacia tree does to not be eaten?
Yeah.
What it does is it sends out this ethylene, and it's smelly and it's awful. Now, not only does it do that, but it blows, you know, it sends messages out in the direction of the giraffe for 100 yards, saying, danger. There's this great big guy with a long neck and he's coming for you. So all of a sudden they're putting this out. Now, just as in real life, there's wind. So if this acacia tree is sending all these, what do you call them, pheromones, they probably are, but they're sending these out to the other trees, and the wind comes along and there's blowback, then this you know, it kind of works against them. So you can look at the wind in a positive or a negative view. So if you're looking at it positively, you can think of the song from the Beaches, the wind beneath my wings, and that is what allows the birds to fly. Or the wind can take something away, but it's the fragrance of the flowers that attract the bees. Back to the mycelium. So just underneath the surface of the ground, you have your little mushrooms popping up, and there's a whole network, and there's a couple of things that are actually on the tree that were really good. In every teaspoon of the, back here, in every teaspoon of soil, there are miles of these tendrils. Miles of these tendrils.
Wow.
In one teaspoon. You know, I mean, you talk about the intestine, and if we took it and we stretched it out, how long it would be. But this, to me, just blew my mind. I thought, miles of these things. So you can just imagine, if you're just going out in a radius under a tree, how many there are. But the trees do the same things, and the roots will interlock, and as they interlock, they're again, you have those two trees. When one dies, the other one dies, because they're in a relationship. They're in a relationship. Oh, here it is. One teaspoon of soil contains many miles of tendrils. And also, what happens underground with these trees is they warn each other of insects, drugs, and other dangers. So they have each other's back, so to speak. You know, and what's better than that? And so Suzanne Simard is the forest ranger in Vancouver. So if anyone wants to Google her, she's fascinating. I mean, she's basically said what I've said. Talks about the mother tree being gone and so forth. I think the part you probably were referring to is.
It was about the fungi being, yeah, it was about, okay. And how the fungi are not really separate.
Yeah, so it's an information superhighway that speeds up interconnections between a large, diverse population of individuals. It allows individuals who may be widely separated to communicate and help each other out. But it also allows them to commit new forms of crime. Listen to this.
Funny.
No, we're not talking about the internet. We're talking about fungi. So there's something called the Zeigarnik effect. And what the Zeigarnik effect is, and I don't know how to spell that, so I'm having a really hard time Googling it and trying out the definition. But I learned it in an internet workshop probably about 20 years ago, over 20 years ago. And what this fellow said was the Zeigarnik effect is what they do just before the commercial, where they leave you hanging. So, you know, you run out and you get your goodies to come back, and then you're there again. So I like to leave this with the Zeigarnik effect so that we can talk about the fungi next time and this interconnection.
Yeah, that's one of the things we can end this. I just want to say that we have one of the things that we talk about when I realize that when we talk about Citizens Forum and we talk about some of these things as if they're over there, and that somehow we're isolated from them, but that's not so. And I think that's typically how the political system treats these things. I mean, the politicians give lip service to doing things about the environment, and nothing ever happens because there are always corporate agendas that are more important. And that's just the way our system works. I just think that's the way our system works. And until we have a different system, that's just the way it's going to continue to work. So, but the thing is that we have to extricate ourselves little by little from the system so that we can maintain our own health, but also so that if and when the system does have a lot of trouble, which a lot of people think that might happen, but we're not so affected. I mean, if you have a garden in your backyard and you have chickens, you're just not going to worry about the fairies shutting down or something as much, because you'll be somewhat prepared. I think we all have the ability. I mean, this has just changed over the past several generations that we're not so closely connected to our food. So that's one of the main points of in Victoria's garden, is how can we get back to that idea that we live in a garden. This is a garden planet.
And in relationship to, what you mentioned, I just want to say one more thing about politicians. When a politician is up for re-election, the communication is like this, the ambience is like this, the loving that we're all together, we're working together happens, then they get elected, and all of a sudden, it's like this. And so we're going from, so this proves to me that people do know how to connect with one another, but somehow, once the salary goes up and they're out here, it's a whole different ballgame. So this is why I like Michael Tellinger's idea, whether anyone believes it or not. I like it because it's talking about, look at you and me. How much do we really work to get what we have? We pray for it, we attend it, we walk out the door and someone says, say, I have an X, and you go, of course you do. That's exactly what I was looking for. I need an X. And they give you an X. You got it. They're happy because they get rid of the X, and you're happy because you have it.